I'd like to now welcome Khalaf Al-Habtour, the chairman of the Habtour Group, to the stage for a keynote speech. Thank you.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I would like to welcome all of you to the reigning country, and it is, we call it blessed. We are blessed today of the rain. We enjoy to see the rain to give us energy and to give us hope and to release the pressure we had sometime. I know a lot of people doesn't like it, but we love it. Also, I would like to welcome you all, the people who's coming from overseas and the people who is living in this beautiful country. I would like to welcome you to the land of the opportunity, the land of opportunity and the safe haven of the world. That's my view, and it has been approved all over the time and the years, the past year and the future. I want to start with my country first, United Arab Emirates. United Arab Emirates, the place, and especially on this time, place for investment. Protected investment, protected from every single thing. Tax exemption, supporting from our government department, action is taken from our government department in no time to support any investor in this country. The return in this country is much higher than anywhere in the world. Well, I have done it myself. I invested overseas and I saw this country will get better return than anywhere in the world. Facility from our government is always there. I mean, all the government department, and I'm talking now about Dubai, that they facilitate it in no time. You can take your license in minutes. You can call the director of that department and they will take decision immediately. And this will not happen anywhere in the world except here in the United Arab Emirates and in Dubai. This is about my country. About Al Habtour Group, we are investing in several things here. We are investing overseas and we are investing here. In the last 2.5 years, we are building Al Habtour City, which has 3 hotels, the St. Regis, W and Western, plus the most advanced theater, water theater in the world, more than Las Vegas, which will be open soon. Plus 3 residential also here, which they have about 1,500 penthouse and apartment. And the most important location, the heart of Dubai is here where you are sitting now. This is the heart of Dubai. And over the canal. And we are starting also, for your information, selling one building. We just finished as well Metropolitan Hotel with a compound of villas. Also, we are finishing soon very landmark project, which is the Polo, Al Habtour Polo Resort and St. Regis, which is the first time St. Regis becoming as a resort in the world, which we're here in Dubai. Something out of this world. Why I'm saying this? I want to say that because I have faith in this country, I have trust in the country, I have trust in this country to invest, and because of the security, because of the transparency, and we as Al Habtour Group, we work as like a public company. We are very much transparent to anyone want to ask, we can answer that. This is as far as us as Al Habtour Group, we are investing. Always I say, we are growing with the United Arab Emirates and we are, working parallel to our government because us and our own as Al Habtour Group or any investor or a business house here, we cannot do it without hand-to-hand with our government in the country here. And the government also, they need us. They need us to work together. Without us and without them, we cannot achieve anything. We have to put our hand together and work to deliver the fruit, the result of our hard work and our planning and our that is important, the coordination and everything, thanks God, is going well. This is as far as business is concerned. There is one issue I want to raise, which is very important. It is related for worldwide. In my last visit to Washington, D.C., I delivered a speech as keynote speaker for decision maker, and there were a lot of important people attending that conference, over 1,000 people, and all of them very, very important people from the U.S. government. And I touched on poverty alleviation. Poverty alleviation, in my opinion, is of the priority to the world. Poverty alleviation, if we can tackle that and put our hand together and talk about that and said, doesn't matter that if we fail one time, two time, three time, four time, we should not give up. We should continue knocking the door for the other and telling them, let us meet, let us discuss this to help. Happening, the resulting from this poverty is terrorism and everything else, drugs, etc., etc., etc. Therefore, I will suggest in this great meeting, beautiful meeting, that somebody like Financial Times and parallel to that, colleagues, everybody who's responsible to take this forward. And I am ready personally to fly anywhere in the world to attend roundtable meeting or conference or whatever, which I prefer around it. Therefore, we can take a decision. I would like to thank you very much, all of you, and thank His Excellency Sami Al-Ghamzi, who is doing great job in this country, and his department, and really all the department of United Arab Emirates and particularly Dubai. Thank you very much.
You have about 5 jobs, it seems. Entrepreneur, investor, businessman, also journalist at times. But taking a step back, what would you say your investment philosophy is based upon?
The way I look at it, always I say in my life, there is 2 things very important. Choice of people, finding the right people, this is one of the most difficult. The second one is to take decision. Not everybody can take decision. Always I say, a decision taken by a man or woman and not taken by male or female. Taken by man or woman, but not female or male.
Sure.
This is why the difference between the people, leadership, is a decision which is the most very important and the most difficult thing in life is the decision.
So it's all about leadership to a certain extent?
100% is the leadership and the people. The people, the key to discuss with them and to find out a solution. And, you know, if I do a project, I will do few scenarios. I don't want to depend on one scenario of study. I will make 1, 2, 3 with different scenario, with different ideas. And we'll look at it, all of us as a group, all my directors, and of course, the decision in mind later, but with their consultation and the green light from them.
It's interesting, just looking around the region, it's a very entrepreneurial culture. I mean, but looking at Dubai as a financial center, what would you say have been the main strengths of Dubai?
Regarding
business, regarding innovation, regarding being an entrepreneur.
I mean, if you look every single day in our paper here, the initiative of our president and vice president, always they are encouraging us and fueling us because they are in front of us. They are working hard. And we cannot sit back. We have to back them up. We have to work with them, support them. This is why they gave us the fuel. They are fueling us. Not the people who you cannot hear them.
No.
Not the people who you cannot see them. Not the people they will not announce.
And every day they announce something positive. This is what gives you energy, to give you a fueling, I call it, fueling to let you think, why not? Let me participate with them. Let me assist them. Let me help them. Not, I will not leave it to them. I will not say what my government is doing. I will say what I have done for them, what I have done for my country.
And that's part of what you're doing as well, isn't it? In terms of philanthropy, yes. Looking at the foundation, yeah. Looking at alleviating poverty, looking to really get involved sure. More. I mean, do you want to just tell me a bit about what spurred that? What was your decision? How did you come to your decision to get involved in philanthropy?
I think the world needs a lot of people. I mean, once I was walking in 6th Avenue in New York, and I saw a lot of flags, Rockefeller, all this building. And with me, one American guy. I said, what a great man. I know the Rockefeller Center, and I know. And he said, no, wait, hold. This has been, he gave it as for the charity, this old street. I was shocked. And somebody will give all what he owned. He said, no, that's not enough. He said he gave the hospital, university, and all the United States as for the charity.
Yes, a lot, absolutely.
I said, this is, I mean, he's blessed. This man is some different. I mean, not like any. This is why I thought, you know, of course we cannot do like Rockefeller. Of course we cannot do like a lot of Americans and Jewish Americans who did great for the nations, but at least we have to step. And you see the initiative which Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid did here. I mean, I cannot count them. I said that the other day on Instagram, few of them only. He did great things. Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed as well, and all of them. I mean, something. Therefore, I thought I should also raise something. I should try to participate, even say one per mil. You know, like a drop in the ocean.
Absolutely.
But it is to give you encouragement, to give you to feel that you are participating, you are helping, you are with the people.
Yeah. It's interesting because I'm certainly looking at some of your articles and looking at the book as well that you've just written, and anybody listening is the name of the book. When you say anybody listening, who are you referring to exactly? Is it the world? Is it the region? Who do you want to listen? Who should listen?
excuse me, just.
No, absolutely.
This was to the world leaders and to the GCC in particular. I was thinking, you know, since a long time, I was concerned, I was worried of the escalation of Iran and that Iran took over Iraq. Gifted by the Americans, unfortunately. And this was the disappointment. This was a disappointment. And, you know, I wasn't happy about that at all. And later, you know, they created the militia.
Yes.
Militia, which is a pro-Iran. And this was, they come in the border. I was dreaming, I was going deep in my dream that they will come, maybe will take Mecca and Medina, which is our holy place. You know, that was worrying me. I was worried about the escalation in Yemen. You know, escalation in other terrorist areas. And I wrote this maybe more than 10 years warning the world of what happening. Just, it was my idea thinking. It wasn't in the ground. Nothing in the ground. Just here in my mind.
Absolutely.
And now what is written in that book is happening now. Happening last year and the year before. If they read what I wrote, it will not happen. They will be like antibiotic to prevent such disease.
And do you think the world is listening now? I mean, certainly a lot of what you wrote has come true, unfortunately.
I hope they will listen. I hope they will read. I hope they will read, because also it's very interesting to read.
We'll take a couple of questions in a second, but just to take you back, I mean, as a 25-year-old engineer, you know, back in the day, if you were to go back and change anything about your life, what would you change, do you think?
First of all, I am not an engineer. I am practical. I work very hard. I pour the concrete. I take the vibrator over the roof and vibrate the concrete. And that time, I don't have a single penny in my pocket. I hire people. I promise them to pay them the salary when I make money.
Well, it worked. It worked very well.
Yes. I took an apartment from a gentleman, with a great guy called Rashid al-Rashid. One bedroom. I said, I don't have money. He said, take it. And this is what I started. And I said, I have no money. When I make money, I will pay you, I promise you. And those people, they trusted me. I don't know why they trusted me. That man, I was a boy, you know. I mean, in the 20s. And
would you change anything in terms of how you, what, how you became successful? Is there anything you look back and think, if only I'd done that instead of gone in that direction rather than this direction?
No, I think I did the right thing.
Yeah.
The right thing. Mistakes here and there, fault here and there, etc. But this is the steps. You have to take the first step. You have, and you know, failing is not a loss.
No.
Failing is not a shame. Failing, after the failing, there is success. Don't give up when you fail. Don't give up. If you fail one time, I failed so many times. If you read my book, my autobiography, I went with my greatest friend, like brother, you know, Muhammad Saeed Al-Ghayth, Allah yadhihi as-sahha wal-afiyah. I went with him, soap factory. I haven't heard about the soap factory. I haven't heard about the soap they make it from the fat. I thought the soap from perfume.
Not quite.
And I put it in residential area, and everybody ran away from that. And then I ran away myself.
Oops, yes.
I mean, this is a failure. Somebody advised me, this is why in business you should not be shy. You should not accept somebody tell you do this, you know, wrong thing, and you accept it, or something you don't know. I mean,
was that like, agreement or disagreement from the audience?
Like, for example, they came to convince me to do jewelry. I'm not a type of jewelry. And when I was a little boy, I ride camels with my father. Well, not jewelry and diamond and this. We didn't know about it. Jewelry, I felt shy with some friend, unfortunately. And then I said, at night, I called the other guy. I said, no, I want my share. I don't trust anybody. And they brought me my share in a bag and cloth. I put it in the safe. After 6 months, I went to give it to my daughter. I found that it's all rusty. They are crooks. This is what happened. And so on.
But
tell you about the failing,
you live and learn, is the point, isn't it, basically?
Yes, of course.
Well, on that note, are there any questions we can take from the audience at this stage? One gentleman over there in the... Stay in the dark suit, but there's quite a few people wearing dark suits, but yes.
Peter Raywood from Ados Holdings. I had the pleasure of actually picking up a copy of your autobiography a few years ago, and it's very intriguing how you've been self-made. Really, that's a key point as far as my question is concerned, because so many people are looking for opportunities here in the UAE and the GCC, and you're obviously a potential strategic partner.
I cannot hear you, sorry.
Yes. As far as a potential strategic partner from abroad that are looking for a strong local partner, what are the qualities you look at in the people that you're doing business with, particularly the fact that you're self-made and have developed your company pretty much from scratch?
Just in case anyone missed that, it's what qualities do you look for in terms of collaboration, in terms of kind of joint ventures, with the people that you work with?
Sir, I have my own way. A lot of people will not agree with me. Therefore, I will be the worst partner. You know, to me, partnership is complicated, very difficult. Maybe joint venture in a project and do it and then divorce. But not forever partnership, because I made partnership with a lot, it failed. You know, I have my own way of management, you have your own way of management. And, you know, it become a little bit complicated. And for investor from overseas, I mean, the country is open for them without partnership. And I personally, for my country, I'm ready to advise anybody to come to my office for anything because I want people to come to my country to invest and to gain money and to make a profit and to live in security and safe in this area. We love people here. This country, sir, is different. If you invest in this country, I will give you an example. I own schools, Emirates International School. We have teachers over 100 nationality. We have children over 120 nationality. And we have different color, different culture, different religion. But we stand under the flag of United Arab Emirates as one family. This is a great country. You cannot compare it with anywhere in the world. I mean, here to invest, this is the place. To buy property, to do your own business, whatever. I mean, I can't tell you this is the place where you will feel comfortable. I will give you a story. You know, we were a British colony here. And when Prime Minister Heath decided to pull out, we were scared. We were worried. They call us trucial state. You know, we are scattered. Later, I met the political agent. He's a good man. I forget his name, long name. Anyway, I said to him, sir, are you leaving or are you staying? He said, no. Already, and I submit my resignation to the British government. I said, why? He said, I cannot leave this country. And that time, we are very small. But we have great leader, Sheikh Rashid. This is before the Federation, I'm telling you. Sheikh Rashid was the greatest leader ever. He's my teacher. And he said, I'm going to stay here, retired here, resign from British government, and die and buried here. I was so proud of that man. So many men from Britain. We used to have the commander of our police, Jack Brex. He was in love with the soil of this country more than anybody else. He died and buried here. We don't mean we are killing them.
Yes, exactly. This may be a shorter conversation than I thought.
Yeah.
Well, let's just take it.
I can tell you the best place to sleep, the best place to enjoy family. I'm talking about families where you have the best education and best security and people will take care. We consider every single person, whether he's US citizen, visitor, Asian, African, or European, we are one family. Because you care about our land, and I care about my land. Thank you.
Let's just take one very, very quick second question. Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Any more? Does anyone have another question to ask? Certainly, sir, over here.
Yes, sir.
There's a microphone just
That's
coming
the problem.
To
I didn't,
you.
I didn't know him at this moment.
Exactly.
مرحبا أبو راشد صباح الخير. I know أبو راشد since many, many years when he used to be flying in and out of Dubai going to the different states and the Gulf over here. أبو راشد, how much do you contribute your success to the late ruler, His Highness Sheikh Rashid and the late ruler Sheikh Maktoum? Thank you.
When I was, you know, we live in Shindaga, this were small area, and always I like to go to with my father. He would take me, you know, on the camera. I was 5 years, 6 years, 8 years, right, coming from that time, you know, and shooting, hunting, you know, and etc. And always we raised camels with Sheikh Muhammad, Sheikh Hamdan, and this. We are all small boys. And I remember Sheikh Khalifa bin Saeed, Allah yarhamah wa ajr al-jannah, he was putting like 5 rupees, we raised, and I don't want to tell you who won, okay? We don't want to political.
We'll find out later.
But that is in the book, you'll find it. Anyway, and later, when I grow, we used to visit some majlises with my father. He'd take me with other children, they were playing, enjoying football, I don't know what, etc. My father, he said, you come with me. He loves me a lot and I love him. He take me and we go to very respectable gentleman which I work, he trained me a lot, Muhammad Saeed al-Mullah, Allah yaatih as-sihha wal-afiyah. And we go there and we sit talking and I was listening. I was maybe what, 8 years, 10 years old, and I was with them all the time with my brother and my father. Later, when I grow a little bit, they start taking me to Sheikh Rashid. This is the answer I'm giving. There, and the majlis of Sheikh Rashid, huge and full, all men sitting around, and when you enter from the door, everybody is looking at you. And you as a child, you will start scared. You will start shaking. One time, two times, I said, I'm not going to go. He said, no, you are going to go. Wallahi ma'ay. I said, Father, I don't feel relaxed. I don't feel comfortable. He said, you are wrong. When you enter to the majlis, look to the eyes of Sheikh Rashid only and consider there is nobody in the majlis. I said, how? There are 200 men. He said, listen to me. And this is the man you can learn from him. This is the man you can learn the way you will be successful if you join him. Go. I said, but I am a boy. He said, doesn't matter. He will pick you up. He will pick you provided he will like you, that you are energetic. He hates people who walk slow, even walking. If you walk slow, he hates you. Muhyiddin, he knows that very well. You have to walk fast, etc. You have to wake up very early. You have to... I meet him 5 times a day. Imagine that. 5 times a day I meet Sheikh Rashid, Allah yarhamah. What a great man. And he pushed me, my father, I sit next to him, he pushed me, he said, go, sit. And then Sheikh Rashid, he asked me, he said, Khalaf, come here. I said to him, and this time I felt, I took deep breath. I said, first time, second time. Then I said, no way on earth. I will go to him early morning at 6 o'clock, 9 o'clock, and 12 o'clock, and 5 o'clock. Muhyiddin, he knows he was with us, Muhyiddin. And I couldn't leave him. I was addict to see this man, to learn, to see his brain working. Even when he's sick in his bed, I go to him, sit with him, to gain energy, to gain positivity. You gain a lot of things to make you comfortable and happy. But he has discipline in life, and Muhyiddin knows very well. He likes people to wake up early. He likes people to work very hard. He doesn't like people to say, I will think, I will try. A word of try or think, he doesn't want to see them again. He is a very wise man. He wants to support everybody and help everybody. He is not a dictator. He is a man of vision, a man of positivity, and he likes people successful, and he will not differentiate whether you are Arab or Indian or English or this. He loves the success of that person.
Fantastic. I'm very conscious of time, but we could go on for much longer. It's fascinating stuff, so thank you very much
for
that.
Thank you, sir.